Now, during last month's meeting, we heard from some of you that we need to consider how to bring our two efforts to better work together to support the community-based efforts in tandem. And of course, we agree with that. So moving forward, we will be more intentional about the collaboration between the shared goals of these two projects. Today, we'll hear from two exciting presenters.
I think we're having trouble with the slides real quick. Cyril, can you share the slides for us, please?
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm having a little technical difficulties with the slides. But here we go. Can everybody see that?
Yep, now we can. If you can just put it in slide mode, that's great.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And go to number three. Oh, let me stop there. Got to give the promotional shout out for the APHA annual meeting in Boston, November 6th through 9th. So if you haven't registered, please do. We look forward to seeing you in Boston. Next slide. Also, I wanted to welcome our fall intern.
Hi, everybody. My name is Cyril May. Yeah, I will be joining for this fall, and I'm here to learn and help as much as possible. So I appreciate it, and I'm glad to be a part of the team. So,
great. So here's our agenda today. Obviously, we're going to have a couple of presentations, and these are both the prioritization of community collaborations, which are really a big aspect of our project. First, we'll hear from Jan Chamas, the lead from the Kentucky Department of Public Health, about the work to transform public health in Kentucky. Then Pastor Joyce Nicholas will share lessons with a strong community partner, the Buffalo Center for Health Equity, and they have formed a rich partnership with a diverse group of cross-sector partners in Western New York, and their goals are to change the social and economic conditions that cause illness and shorten lives along the sickest in their region. And then after these two presentations, we have time for questions and some group dialogue. So with that, let me turn it over to you, Angie.
Thanks so much, everybody. We are so excited about the presentation today. We're welcome to Cyril. One additional update that we have is that we've recently updated our Alliance website. So I think we'll add now to the chat just the page. Feel free to check it out when you have a chance. We hope to continue to add things along the projects we're working on around prioritization and other. And so we'll look forward to seeing that grow over time, but really want to thank our communications folks and Ryan and others for helping us to get that going. Next, we are so fortunate to have what I think will be a really great panel today. We're going to cover both lessons from the two prongs that Dr. Benjamin was just mentioning to you of the work that the Alliance has started recently, both trying to think about how we can prioritize and come to a common set of next steps for us in public health if we're trying to get to that new, resilient, equitable, effective system that we're hoping to get to, working with partners and others. And then also just as important, figuring out how we can support some of the really amazing cross-sectoral community efforts happening on the ground. So today we have leaders from two different initiatives, one coming at it a little bit more from the perspective of the first project. So Jan Chamness, who's the Director of Public Health Transformation at the Kentucky Department for Public Health. We'll talk about her work first. And then we're so fortunate to hear from Pastor George Nicholas, who's the chairman of the Buffalo Center for Health Equity. So I will introduce Jan now and let her tell us some about their work in Kentucky. Then we'll take a couple questions. We'll move on to the presentation from the Buffalo Center for Health Equity. And then we'll really look forward to talking to all of you all, both about how we really connect to these efforts and learn from them. But we hope they're really great stories for all of us as we're thinking about what to do as a whole, looking collectively at what we can do as a nation, about how we can all start to advance public health and equity around the country. With that, I will turn it to Jan, and we will let her share her screen. But Jan, as I mentioned, is the Public Health Transformation Director for the Kentucky Department for Public Health. Public health transformation is a set of initiatives launched in 2019 to modernize Kentucky's public health system, to get towards a more sustainable programs and processes, and affect policy change aimed at improving health outcomes. She participates in, facilitates conversations and researches public work on public health modernization and transformation policy initiatives at the national level, and reviews lessons from other states. For many of you all, something else really exciting is that she was the public health director for the Montgomery County Health Department before she came here. There she led her team to secure HRSA grants to establish a crematorious and community health worker program. She also played a role in applying for and securing funding for the Sterling Health Solutions, which is now Sterling Healthcare. So an FQHC, which provides primary medical, dental, and mental health services in seven counties. She was the board chair and serves as their board of directors. She has a master's in public health from UK and also an undergrad degree in health services administration. So we are so pleased to have Jan here. And I will now turn it over to you, Jan. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Angie. Let me go ahead and get this technical stuff out of the way. And okay. So everybody can see that? All right, great. Well, thank you so much. It is such an honor to be able to talk to you all today about public health transformation and what's going on in Kentucky. We are not unlike a lot of other states across the country seeking to really modernize public health and certainly to improve the health of our community. So, what I'm going to talk about today is just sort of a foundational presentation on why we decided to go toward public health transformation, why it was needed, and how we're getting there. And so let me just go ahead and get started. There were a few reasons why public health transformation became very important to Kentucky. And the first one I want to show you is a map of Kentucky and all of the counties. And yes, we have 120 counties in Kentucky. And I won't go into a lot of detail about the pension crisis, but that was really kind of the final straw that really pushed us into prioritizing public health transformation in Kentucky. There was a pension crisis, and had we not have made this move toward transformation, those counties in red would have faced closing their doors within about a year. The yellow counties had about 2 years, and the white counties would have had at most maybe 5 years before they became financially unsustainable to be able to provide services in their communities. And the second reason why we wanted to move forward with public health transformation was really because of the national initiatives that have been going on for the last 20 years. We have talked about these throughout Kentucky and throughout our local health departments. Certainly on the left-hand side is the 10 essential services that were introduced back in early 2000s, and then the Public Health 3.0, which was introduced by the CDC a little bit later. And as most of you know, these two models work in concert and complement one another, and they make sense in terms of what public health really needs to be at the local level, at the state level, and at the national level. So we really wanted to get on this bandwagon of moving forward along with the national initiatives that were going forward. But I think probably the most important reason why we wanted to push forward with public health transformation was basically, just simply stated, what we were doing was not working. Our health outcomes still rank very low in terms of health behaviors and health outcomes. We're at the bottom of the list, along with some other states that tend to be there, mostly in that southern corridor, when it comes to diabetes and heart disease and certain types of cancers. And so we really knew that for those reasons and the others that I stated, we really had to move forward with public health transformation. So we set about to make some goals for public health transformation, and I'm gonna have to move my pictures here because they're over my, okay. So just real quickly to go over our goals in Kentucky for public health transformation was certainly, as I said, with the pension crisis and some other financial constraints, we wanted to relieve the fiscal instability of the current system. We wanted to introduce a modern, simplified and focused public health model, create accountability at all levels, improve public health leadership capacity, prevent duplication of effort and red tape, and support and emphasize data-driven decision-making and promote evidence-based and promising practice interventions. And so we came up with this categorization and prioritization of public health programs. And for lack of a better term, I call this sort of the key slide. It really breaks down that categorization of public health programs. So within core public health, you see this foundational public health list of services. And if you look at those, I think that probably most of you are familiar. These are not uncommon to some of the foundational public health framework that's been introduced by NACHO and ASTO and other organizations, supported also by APHA. And you'll see those things as those focus areas of population health, enforcement of regulations, emergency preparedness and response, communicable disease, and administrative and organizational infrastructure. And then also within that core public health is WIC, HANDS, and programs related to harm reduction and substance use disorders. And the reason why those were left in, WIC and HANDS are two programs that they're big programs within our local health department system. They have been predominantly offered through the local health departments. And then just harm reduction and substance use disorder programs. We need, those need to be part of our core public health just because of the epidemic that we have in Kentucky with drug use and abuse. So we needed to be at the table for that and to take a leading role in that. And then to the side, there's this box that we call local public health priorities. We also refer to it as the green box program. And what that is all of those other programs that really make up public health in each of our communities. Every community is unique, but what public health transformation says is you must first offer these core public health programs, and those must be funded and prioritized first. And then based on your community health assessment or local needs assessment, then we would invite you or offer you the choice of pursuing some of these local public health priority programs that would help improve the health of your communities. And so those would be programs like diabetes, school health, cancer screenings, tobacco cessation. There's probably around within how we define those programs, there's probably level can pursue grant opportunities. And these would be those programs that based on your community health assessment, you would pick and choose which top five that you wanted to provide. And I say the top, three to five, because as a former local health department director, what we tried to do is we tried to offer all of those programs. And as you know, when you offer all of those programs, you're not effective in any of them. And, it's that old model of mile wide and inch deep. And so we, through public health transformation and through this prioritization and categorization of public health funds, we really encourage local health departments to really prioritize what those top three to five programs might be, and then pursue funding that would align with that and allow them to offer those programs. Public health transformation became really serious in 2020 when we presented through our legislators, we proposed the public health transformation bill. And basically the public health transformation bill took that key slide of that categorization and prioritization of public health programs and initiated this bill, which was passed and led to amendments that put all of that in place. So KRS, which is Kentucky Revised Statutes 211-185, shows that categorization of public health programs. Then the second amendment emphasized this local needs assessment, this requirement in order to offer those local public health priority programs. And then to really make it important for local health departments, we also proposed a new funding strategy or a new funding formula based on public health transformation and based on those foundational public health programs and how we fund local health departments. In addition to the law, we also have undergone a major review and revision of our own strategic plan. And so the strategic plan, it was due to be reviewed and revised. It was about 5 years old and really did not, it was no longer relevant in terms of public health transformation and what we were trying to accomplish there. So the strategic map and public health transformation align with one another now. And this map is sort of our one-page visual, our one-page infograph that we share when we just want to kind of give a high-level overview of our strategic plan. And you can see there those hexagons of people, quality, efficiency and effectiveness, and building public health capacity. Those are our four strategic priorities. And then for all intents and purposes, we really added two more strategic priorities. Health equity had always been a part of our strategic plan, but we really never put the focus on it that it needs today. And so we really wanted to add that in terms of promoting health equity in all we do, making sure that we look through all of our programs with a health equity lens. And then at the bottom, communication has certainly been important, but again, we wanted to elevate the level of importance and priority for communication. And so it is our sixth strategic priority in terms of strengthening internal and external communication. In summer of 2020, and I know a lot of you don't really want to remember that time because it was at the height of COVID, and we were all certainly neck deep or head over heels or over our head in addressing the COVID pandemic. Not that we still aren't, but it has become part of our new normal. I think we all agree that COVID is probably not gonna go away. We just have to figure out how to manage it in our day-to-day, which I think all of us are doing. But in the summer of 2020, we realized, our commissioner realized at that time that COVID was gonna continue for a while. And knowing that, and knowing that there would be another side to COVID, there would be this new normal, I think the lessons that we were learning and we're going to continue to learn gave him the impetus to get public health transformation back on the priority. And so we really kind of began to do some very intensive planning in terms of operationalizing the law and categorization and prioritization of those public health programs. So moving from that whole year and a half of planning, going through and developing subcommittees and really a structure that would operationalize public health transformation, we're kind of on the other side of that. We're kind of now going from planning to implementing and making sure that public health transformation really become somewhat of a culture in Kentucky's public health system and not some program that we, you know, that we have a step-by-step book. There is no step-by-step book for public health transformation. Every day is a new day and every program we need to look at differently through the lens of public health transformation. So I talk about going from process to culture. I talk about going from, you know, sort of this programmatic platform, all of these programs and trying to offer all of them and not being very effective at any of them because we try to do too many at one time, to more of this comprehensive, holistic approach of let's identify what our top needs are and let's go after programs that can help address those. We really want to get away from direct patient care and more into population health. There are times in local health departments where we can't do that, but we really want to rely on our partners to be able to pick up some of those services. That's what they're there for. And we don't need to, in any circumstance, we don't need to compete with any of our providers out there in our communities. And so I also talk about going from provider to partner and really establishing those partnerships with other providers in other areas that are health issues like mental health or drug use or like I said, diabetes, things like that. We really want to identify our partners out there that can help us address some of those health issues. Really looking at everything through this health equity lens. Again, this emphasis on communication at all levels, whether it's with our staff or at the local level or with our community partners or our state partners or even our national partners. And then really moving forward with this enhanced performance management quality improvement program that constantly and continuously looks at how we do things and how we can do them better. I'm not going to read all of these to you, but this is what our vision for public health transformation looks like in the future. Some of these have come to fruition and some of these we're still working on, but this is really just a sampling of what we hope public health transformation continues to do. I'll let you peruse those. But I want to note that in emphasis at the bottom, we hope to see a marked improvement in health behaviors and health outcomes. I wanted to give you just a little sample of what public health transformation looks like at the local level. I can give you several examples of what we've done over the past 2.5 years, but I thought that this was probably the most relevant and certainly emphasizes the importance of our partnerships at the local level. One of our district health departments down in Eastern Kentucky that was hit hard by the floods in the summer came together and did a mental health convening. It was the Kentucky River District Health Department, which represents 7 counties, and another county participated in this convening. It was prompted by the Eastern Kentucky floods, as I said, a few months ago. They recognized that there was a serious need for mental health services during the recovery efforts. And there is a group of people that have been meeting since 2017 and probably even before. They just formalized their group in 2017. But it's called the Kentucky River Health Consortium. And these partnerships were previously formed to address other health issues. But the director of the health department down there, he by education is a mental health professional. So he reached out to all of the mental health providers in that 7-8 county area, brought them all together and said, you know, we've got some major gaps in providing mental health services for the victims of the floods. And so they came together to discuss strategies and implement those strategies. So I felt like that was really a very recent and relevant example of how important it is to have those partnerships at the local level. So that is my overview. I know I went through those slides pretty quickly, but I just wanted to kind of give you a high level of what's going on in Kentucky. So,
thank you so much, Jan. Kind of as we transition or whatever, I did want to ask you, I think one thing that's really informative for us is this all started before COVID. So just real quick, what are a couple of things that you saw that changed or that were, you know, worked or didn't work based on kind of what we dealt with the COVID pandemic?
Well, I think a couple of things. You know, we certainly recognized how important our partners were at both the local and the state level. And I think that COVID removed a lot of those barriers and a lot of those maybe inhibitions about getting together with partners and taking the time to get with partners. Certainly partnerships were the key to addressing the pandemic all of the needs that occurred during the pandemic. And so it was easier to bring those partners back together and talk about public health transformation. In fact, you know, there were a few months when we were still in the planning stage before we really brought partners into the fold. And I think that as we continued to get into COVID in 2021, the opportunity to get together and talk about anything but COVID was very enticing to people. They needed a break from COVID. And so we learned a lot of lessons just about the importance of of partnerships and how important they are to making all of this happen. I've always said that public health does not happen within the four walls of a health department. It is out in the community that we address those issues.
Thank you so much. And with that, I think you just gave us the perfect transition to our next presentation. and just for everybody, we'll come back and have both questions for Jan and for Pastor Nicholas in Buffalo right after his presentation. But I'll now turn it over to our colleagues from Buffalo, but want to introduce you to Pastor George Nicholas. He has a master's in divinity, and he is the senior pastor of Lincoln Memorial United Methodist in Buffalo, New York. He's been recognized for his work on urban ministries. He's an advocate for social justice and the community revitalization. He's also a founding member of Concerned Clergy Coalition of Western New York. What's, I guess, most exciting to me, perhaps, is that he also has a passion for public health. And he helped found the African American Health Equity Task Force, which birthed this Buffalo Center for Health Equity that we'll hear about today. He's the chair of the Buffalo Center for Health Equity, which I think otherwise is written sometimes BCHE if you see it. He also serves on the board of directors for Health eLink and the executive committee of the board of Population Health Collaborative. He has an undergrad degree from the Ohio State University, and also a graduate degree from SUNY at Buffalo and Colgate Rochester Divinity School. And so I'll turn it over to you to hear about some of the great work happening in Buffalo. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you so much for your kind words. And Jan, thank you for your presentation and sharing what's going on in the bluegrass state of Kentucky. I want to just kind of talk to you a little bit about our story here in Buffalo, New York. And as I give you this information, I want you to think about three things. One, the importance of understanding the problem and the root causes that drive poor health outcomes. Two, the importance of building the type of coalitions and partners and collaborations that are necessary to really address the social determinants of health. And then three, the importance of advocacy in terms of creating a climate and environment of urgency that is so necessary to address these issues. Next slide. So to begin our story, you have to think about Buffalo was in the national spotlight on May 14th for the horrific domestic terrorist attack upon 10 or even more folks that were wounded. But these 10 beautiful citizens, many of them who I knew personally, and with this event happened about a mile away from where our church is and where we were actually handing out food. That morning. But what happened with there was a tragic event. But what it did also is it exposed to a lot of people within our community the just dire conditions of the African-American community and how the social determinants of health really are driving these poor health outcomes. When this event happened at the top supermarket, the supermarket was shut down. And when the supermarket was shut down, that was one of the main venues, in many ways, the only venue for many people on the east side of Buffalo, where about 80% of Black people live, could get access to fresh food and groceries and things of that nature. So it was really ironic that not only the terrorist attack of the murder of these 10 beautiful people was tragic enough, but it also, as people converged onto that community give their condolences, they realized, they saw, wow, this is a community that really has a lot of needs and a lot of issues. And so we want to take advantage of the spotlight of one, what the COVID-19 situation, which exposed the tremendous health disparities in the region, and then the issue of this violent attack upon our community that exposed a lot of the issues around food access that also drive the social determinants of health and poor health outcomes. So here's our story. So back in about 2015, we began, and maybe even a little sooner than that, we began to have conversations about health outcomes in the African-American community. It began with a conversation about colorectal cancer, but then we expanded our understanding to look at all the kind of chronic diseases that are impacting the African-American community. And in our studies and in our work, just looking at county and state statistics, we found that if you look at five or six zip codes in the, where about 80% of African-Americans live in the county of Erie, you'll find that if you are African-American and live in that community, you are 300% more likely to have a chronic disease than if you were white that lived outside of those communities. And so we have, in Buffalo, we have some of the worst residential segregation in America. We have some of the worst poverty of the northern industrial communities. And it's really driven by just the really horrific numbers that are in the African-American community. And we're very intentional. Let me just make this point, that we're very intentional about focusing on health outcomes of the African-American community. While we're concerned about health outcomes in the general community, but when you look at the data of Erie County, where I think in New York State, we have 64, 65 counties in New York State, Erie County is consistently ranked 63, 64 in the state for health outcomes. Why is that? Well, if you look at the data for African Americans in that county, the numbers are so bad that it pulls the entire county number down. And so it's very important that we look at the social determinants of health and really focus on the root causes of what are driving these health outcomes. So we started this African-American Health Equity Task Force, and we began to extend invitation. It really started with people at the community level, grassroots level, but then we reached out to partners in the healthcare industry. We reached out to partners at the University of Buffalo, which was a very important and strategic move on our part. The University of Buffalo had just recently built this really vast and high-tech new medical school. But they built it really in the African-American community, and there was a lot of tension and stress about that whole process, and there still is. And so the university really had an opportunity here to try to engage the community in a way in which it had not done in the past. And myself as a leader, you know, took a little heat for trying to work with the university because they were not really considered a friend to the community, and some still don't think they're a friend. But my argument and our position was that they have resources that we desperately need to help us solve the problems that we see in our community. And one of those big resources is research. And so we began our relationship with the University of Buffalo with the School of Nursing, and then reached into the medical school. But then as we focused on the social determinants of health, we recognized that we have to have transformation, not only what happens within the healthcare system, but more importantly, what happens in the general population. So that way we began to engage the School of Social Work, the School of Law, the School of Business, the Management School, and all the different academic disciplines that the university has, and began to pull them together and into this task force with community folks. In 2017, we had our first conference called Igniting Hope, where we brought scholars in from all around the country to begin to start talking about the issues of health equity. At that conference, we declared that we were going to, one of our goals was to establish a separate 501c3 corporation that really focused on eliminating race-based health disparities. Over time, at the 2018 conference, we were able to announce the establishment of the Buffalo Center for Health Equity, and we were seeded $372,000 from the County of Erie to begin our process of capacity building. Now, as you move down the timeline in 2019, we, through our leadership, we helped establish the Community Health Equity Research Institute, which is embedded in the University of Buffalo. So now we have two entities that are working on health equity issues. One at the community-based level, the Buffalo Center, and two, the University Community Health Research Institute. And both of these organizations are cross-populated by individuals and people that are working on the task force. When COVID-19 hit our region, we knew because of the research that we had already done that, and the fact that the African-American community had such high rates of asthma, heart disease, diabetes, and other things that made people more susceptible to COVID-19, that the African-American community was going to be hit the hardest. And we also knew that a lot of the frontline workers, the people who are working in the hospitals, not necessarily the nurses and the doctors, but the support, the people who worked in those hospitals, in dietary, in laundry, in security, in transportation, many of those people came from those very zip codes that we talked about. And we knew that those people would be very vulnerable. So we put in place, working with the County of Erie, what we called the COVID-19 Project. And what this project did was we literally called everybody who lived in our community, whether by the phone or we've been partnering with the National Witness Project or community health workers. We actually, in the midst of COVID, were knocking on doors, checking on our people and making sure they had access to primary care. We wanted to find out whether they have the information about COVID-19, or did they have a need for mental health services, they need help for getting food. We had all these things in place. And by doing so, when we looked at the original or the first layer of data coming out of Erie County, which showed the fatalities, Buffalo, African-Americans in Erie County, in the city of Buffalo, represented about 33% of the deaths, where we only made up 14% of the population. Well, that was in alignment with the national 2.5 to 3 times. But through our work on the COVID-19 project, we were able to reduce that number of fatalities down to right to about 14%, which is right at the population rate. This was attributed to a lot of the work that we were doing in terms of our project, in terms of we had about 5 or 6 different churches that were call centers. We engaged people in the community to give out information. We set up sites for testing. For when the vaccine came out, we were very active in engaging the community on the issues of vaccine hesitancy and vaccine access. And one of our partners, and so the Buffalo Center for Health Equity, we're actually like a think tank, but we also support other entities within the community. And one of them was Project Reach, which is funded through the CDC. And there was a very robust Prairie Street Health and Wellness Project where we really went out into the community and giving out information and giving people access to care. Where we lie right now is where we are calling you from today is from our new office, which is in the Highmark building downtown in the city of Buffalo. Highmark has been a great partner with us, investing some significant resources in us and unrestricted dollars for a 5-year term to help us build up our organization so we can begin to work on the 5 pillars of our organization, Sam. And those things, the 5 pillars of our group, of our organization, is one, research, where we want to really have robust research on what is the problems and what are the things, what are the real numbers in our community. And this research really is also going to be a community participatory research. We have a project through the PCORI project that looks the PCORI Foundation that gives us resources to do what we call a Mellowing Minds project, research project, where we're looking at using mindfulness to help deal with the trauma of just being Black in America, but also the trauma that was increased or amplified during the COVID-19 pandemic. The next pillar is policy development. We understand that public policy has a tremendous impact on the social determinants of health. So we want to be able to play a very strong role in in working with our elected officials and other influencers to have public policy that will have a positive impact on the social determinants of health. Number two, the three is neighborhood development. We know that you cannot really help a community unless we help their neighborhood. You can't have a conversation about improving health outcomes unless you look at the lived environment where people live. And so it's very important that we look at how a public policy and neighborhood development and community development impacts health outcomes. We worked with Dr. Henry Taylor at the University of Buffalo in publishing a report that talked about residential segregation. It's called The Harder We Run, that really documented how over the last 25, 30 years, even though Buffalo has had a quote unquote resurgence, but that resurgence has bypassed the Black community. And there's still a large number of African-Americans who are living in substandard housing. And again, we can, through our mapping, we can directly look at how those things have an impact on health outcomes. Then advocacy and public and governmental relationship. Advocacy is really, really key. Through our work, we realized that in the city of Buffalo, in those communities, there was this policy that the city government was doing called where they were doing ticketing. They were just ticketing cards for things like tinted windows, busted headlights, under the cover of trying to identify more hardened criminals. Well, you know, that was a completely failed policy. And what was happening is that the disproportionate amount of people in the African-American community were the ones that were getting these tickets, they were getting their cars towed. And again, you can look, and those were the same areas where you had these terrible health outcomes. So through our organizing and advocacy, we created the Fair Fines and Fees Coalition, and we were able to get all 12 of these fines and fees overturned in the city of Buffalo. And then finally, the community engagement. You know, we really believe that the people at the community level understand their issues, and they also understand how systems and institutions and government can help them. And so we want to really have a robust community engagement process. We dedicate about 20% of our budget to community engagement activities, which helps us in getting a better snapshot of what's going on in our community, but it also informs us on really the impact of the social determinants of health and on health outcomes. Finally, I want to really talk to you really quickly, I know I'm over time, is about the importance of building coalitions. You know, what's unique about our story here in Buffalo is that we really have been very intentional about addressing the issues of race, systemic racism, historical racism, however you want to characterize it. And understanding that that is a major driver in these poor health outcomes. Those are often difficult conversations when you're engaging with institutions, health insurance companies, or others that where there's a lot of discomfort of really having these conversations. But we've taken that conversation head on and really have invited these partners to really partner with us in a true partnership, a true collaboration, not something that's episodic, coming together just to fill out a grant application, but really inviting folks to work shoulder to shoulder with us on addressing these issues. And as you can see that on the one side of the slide, you see that's just a small sample of the number of partners that we have working in the city around health equity, institutions that we, you know, like insurance companies, health insurance companies, hospital systems, educational institutions, working alongside community and grassroots folks to begin to start working on these problems. The final piece I want to really just talk and impress upon you is there's a sense of urgency. You know, we have been engaged in this work around health equity really since around 2014. And I got to be honest with you, it was very difficult for us to really get people to think that this was such an important issue for our community. But through our persistence and through inviting people to come to the table, through looking at the data, sharing the data, and talking about and making those connections with around, you know, the poor outcomes of our educational system, the disparities in economic opportunities for Black people here in this region, for the over-policing of our communities, we've been able to make very strong arguments and very strong partnerships in community to really address these issues. When COVID-19 hit, and then with the unfortunate issue occurrence on May 14th, it's really put us in a very strong position to really begin to start to influence how money is being spent, how a policy is being formed, how corporate leaders are interacting with our community. And that's all through a relationship building. So now that we've built these relationships, now we have to create a sense of urgency. And then we have to encourage people to make their investments as you look at how you're going to shape this community, make those investments be looked at through the lens of health equity and the social determinants of health. So I'm gonna leave some time for some conversation and questions. This is just a small part of our story. And if you need to know more information about what we're doing here in Buffalo, you can go onto our website with the Buffalo Center for, buffalohealthequity.org. And this is, again, just another example of the importance that we do in terms of looking at community needs assessment. We're in the process now working with our third leg. We've helped establish within the County of Erie Office of Health Equity, right in the County of Erie Department of Health. So through our work, we've been able to birth three organizations. One, Buffalo Center for Health Equity. Two, the UB Community Research Institute. And now three, the Erie County Department of Health Equity. And all three of us, all those three of those entities work in collaboration with one another to help establish a more healthy community. Again, if you wanted more information about what we did, because we really don't, you know, this was a real brief overview, please look at our website, buffalohealthequity.org. We have a Facebook page and we have a podcast. And you see there, the one young lady there, Zanetta Everhart, her son was one of the young men that was shot, but thanks be to God that he was not murdered on May 14th. And she has been a very active partner with us from the beginning around health equity, works directly with one of our state senators, Tim Kennedy, and has been a real great leader in our community. So I'm gonna pause there and so that we have some time for some conversation with either myself and Jan. I hope this has helped you out a little bit today.
Thank you so much. This has been great. And I know we started questions. I'm actually going to turn it to one of the ones in the chat feature, if that's okay. But just to let everybody know, we will share slides after this. And I know the Buffalo presentation, I believe, has a video. You can see the podcast and others to learn more about their work. And there's a lot more we could have talked about around Kentucky, too. Before we go to the broader discussion, Pastor Nicholas, we got a question about, could you speak to the role level of involvement? You mentioned some about your local health department, but also how has your state health department been involved in your work and coalition?
The Erie County Health Department has been a good partner. It's an evolving relationship, right? Because one of our things that we emphasize is really looking at root causes and the things that are driving the health outcomes, as opposed to about programmatic things. We're not against programs, right? But we're really more focused on not growing the service system, but reducing the need for people in our community for so many services, right? Which is a different kind of a conversation that historically has been had with the health department here in Erie County. But I think with Erie County establishing right there and embedding it in their office, this office around health equity, and you know, one of our leaders from the task force became the director of it. And so it's really, and we're really right now engaged in a very robust community needs assessment that doesn't only focus on things that happen inside the healthcare system, but really the factors outside. That's been pretty good, and it's ongoing.
That's great. I'm going to do one more question, just for Buffalo. Alice, would you like to ask your question? More fun to hear from you than me.
Okay.
Yes.
So
what you've done. Yes.
Hi, Alice. How are you? I remember you.
Sorry, I didn't know you were moving.
Hi.
All good.
Got your Spike Lee thing going on with your walk. But so our funding, so from about 2014 to just about a year ago, we were really just kind of a volunteer-based organization, right? Through developing some strategic plans and some other things, we were able to get a significant investment from Highmark. Highmark, which is a health insurance company here in the city. We've also gotten some funding through the Rite Aid Foundation on a food equity project, and really some other smaller grants. And then for the funding for our conferences is come through a grant that we did in partnership with the University of Buffalo from the NIH. And then there are also other corporate sponsors that have helped in investing in our work. We really haven't, and then the Health Foundation of Western New York has helped us as well. But we really haven't tapped into a lot of the foundations quite as yet, because we've been more, you know, we're not just going to go out there and get money for money's sake. We want to make sure that there's some real strong connection to what our mission is, right? To what we're asking for. So we're very sensitive about doing mission creep, right? So we have a lot of people always ask us, hey, you want to apply to this? And I said, well, not necessarily, because it's not what we do, but we'll point you to entities within the community that actually do a good job at that work. And we're actually funding some other organizations too. So that's the thing, you know, that we want to do as well.
That's really exciting. Thank you. So a question for everybody. I think we've heard two really amazing examples, and a question that we can, you know, ask our presenters, but also are just, what are lessons that we've heard today that, as we're all trying to think about where we transform public health, that we really need to focus on? I certainly heard partnerships. I heard true engagement. I heard the need to really think about what really matters. I think from Jan in Kentucky, we can't do everything. So how can we really focus on a couple of key things? Anything else that kind of struck people is something that for all of us, we need to be thinking about as we move ahead. And you can use the chat as well as raise your hand, and I'm happy to call on folks.
You know, can I just comment real quickly? This is not a PowerPoint, Jan. Don't you hear that at all, please. But one of the things that we say to people is, you got to do everything. Right. I mean, especially when you're talking about the issues of historical racism and systemic racism, you know, we really believe, like, a lot of times people want to help children. Well, you can't help children without helping their family. And when I hope in their you can't really help their family if you don't help their neighborhood. And you can't really help their neighborhood unless you address the policies and things that help shape those neighborhoods. And so, you know, a lot of times people do accuse me of trying to boil the ocean. But what I say to them is, let's go get some wood and get it started. Because the reality is, unless when you look at the social determinants of health and what's happened with, you know, in our community, speaking of this African American community, unless we really are honest with what is really driving these poor health outcomes, and it may seem like too much, but unless we really address those things, we won't get the type of outcomes that we're looking for, right? And so I recognize that, you know, programmatically you can't do everything, but I think strategically, when you think about what's driving these health outcomes, you got to talk about education, you got to talk about crime, you got to talk about the environment, you got to talk about housing, right? And all these things are very important factors. And that's what we focus on.
That's great. Jan, any other lessons from Kentucky around how do we kind of balance everything versus, I know you all did some narrowing, but it sounds like you also really looked at the big picture, which is great.
Well, don't misunderstand me that I don't think that, you know, when I say that we have to pick and choose 3 to 5, I take that in the context of as a health department, as a local health department entity, we can't take on all of the problems, which points to the fact of how important partnerships are. And so you're right, all of it's important. And so how do we engage partners to address some of those other programs where they might do a better job and we can serve in a, you know, in an assistive role more than in the role where we're trying to be the providers of those programs. So, you know, you list out public health programs and all of those social determinants of health. They're all interrelated. They're all connected, and you can't do one without recognizing the other. But I think that we have to really engage partners in looking at all of that, and then identifying what our skill set and what our expertise is in any particular area, and be the ones who drive that, and then be the supportive role in partners who want to drive the other.
Thank you, that's great. I know we're pretty much out of time, but I know one thing we got a couple questions about from folks are just really, if you had kind of one lesson for us or one thought about it for us, about how we really elevate equity in the work that we're all doing, what would you say? And Jan, I'll start with you because I see you still have your mute off.
So repeat the last part of the question.
Sorry, just in general, if you had kind of a lesson that you learned about how to really elevate equity, and you know, you said you were going to, you know, move towards using that lens, what would be something you would kind of share with us that you thought was helpful?
Well, I think it's important that, you know, we put action to health equity and not just talk a lot about it. There are a lot of tools out there that we can use that really we can apply to programs that sort of ensure that there's a health equity lens. So I think that we have to really be intentional in what we are trying to do with health equity and not just use it as something that, you know, we like to say it a lot, but then how to do it or how to operationalize it is another thing.
Great, thanks. And final word, Pastor Nichols.
The final word is priority. You know, I'll leave with this one of my examples. Well, you know, when you look at your phone or look at what we're doing today, right? We're able to make this connection. And if I would have told you that 20 years ago, somebody would tell you, oh, you're trying to boil the ocean. You can't do anything like that. But it was a priority, right? It was a priority that we have this level of expertise in what we have. So let's make health equity a priority in this country. And once it's a priority, a real priority, then the investments will come and the structural and systemic changes that are necessary in order to make the change, they will follow that. We got to get people to make this a real, real priority and not just, you know, the fad of the week.
Thank you. I think that is a great concluding point. Thank you so much to both of you all for letting us hear about what's happening in Kentucky and Buffalo. I think what you all have learned and started is hopefully something that the rest of us can really learn from and build on, as well as partnering with all of you all, so that hopefully we can learn how to all do this better together. Thanks, everybody. Have a great rest of the month. Hopefully we'll see a bunch of you all in Boston, but you know, we'll share these presentations and look forward to connecting again soon. Thanks so much, everybody.